Thanks everyone for joining us for this very first panel of this very packed day of webinar. So we're starting out with a panel on the green mining violence nexus, looking at the different ways in which these are entangled, as well as the facilitating conditions that actually help produce violence. And we're having four papers in this session. We start out with a paper that looks at the major strategies in the green transition from miners to material solutions providers. So looking more at the corporate the side by Mats Barbesgaard from Lund University and Andy Whitmore from the London Mining Network. Then we're moving into a panel on the enabling ideologies of Australia's new green extractive frontier, a narrative analysis by Claire Burgess from the University of Tasmania. She's had some trouble to put on her video. We'll see if that can be solved, and otherwise we can at least still listen to her presentation. A third panel is on the predatory connection, nickel coal extraction, oligarchs and green energy in Indonesia by Siti, Maimunah from the University of Passau and Melki Nahar from JETM Indonesia. And this panel or this paper will be shortly introduced by Marta Conde from the Universidad Autónoma de Barcelona. And finally, we're going to look at violence and green extractivism-induced social and environmental change in Cabo Delgado, Mozambique. A paper by Emilinah Namaganda from Utrecht University. So to save time and without further ado, I give the floor to Mats and Andy.
Thanks a lot. Can you all see the slides and hear me and everything?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. All right, starting the timer. We have a tight timeline, so I'll jump right in. My name is Mads. I'm a teacher and researcher at Lund University and also a researcher with the Transnational Institutes. And I'm presenting with Andy Whitmore from the London Mining Network. And so our presentation today is actually based on a report that was released on Wednesday. Called Smoke and Minerals, How the Mining Industry Plans to Profit from the Energy Transition. And so you can find that on TNI's and LMN's website, so hope you check it out. But shortly, the publication and the presentation is actually based on Andy's and my participation in the Financial Times Mining Summit back in October. Called Enabling the Energy Transition and some subsequent sort of research that we did. And what was clear at that summit is that, of course, for the miners, the energy transition is seen as a massive profit opportunity, right? And so that draws on the energy transition conceived purely in terms of an energy substitution, right? And so there were ample references, for example, to this report, the figure on the left from the International Energy Agency, which highlights how the transition to these clean energy technologies puts massive demand on a whole host of minerals, right? The so-called transition minerals that I'm sure you're all aware of. And so in this context also, as you see on the figure to the right, there's been a very significant rise in prices coming out of Corona, or you know, whatever phase we're in at the moment, at least on the other side of 2020, a huge rise in prices in copper here, but also in many of the other transition minerals. And so, of course, for the majors or the mining companies that can supply these minerals, these high prices promise huge prospective profits, right? And so as an Anglo-American representative pointed out in the conference, while capital may be slow to come, come it will, right? So exploration strategies are developing at the moment in terms of opening up new opportunities for extraction. And so Whit and I thought that it would be useful to try and examine sort of kind of take the corporations on their own terms, right? And try and understand take the matrix basically as unit of analysis, right? And so why does that make sense? We think that's important because, of course, corporations are a central actor under capitalism. And so their strategies of appropriation and transformation of nature are important to more closely examine, right? And so in this case, through mining. In terms of who, so as said, what we look at are the majors, and you have a figure there of the top 20 mining companies in 2021, at least. And so we're going to be hearing a lot more about violence, but actually in our analysis, we try to take the majors more sort of on their own terms, so to speak, in political economy terms. So approaching them as, you know, profit-seeking entities operating under the imperative of competitive accumulation, right? And so looking at their own strategies. And of course, violence doesn't figure explicitly in those, although as we'll hear in many of the coming presentations, violence is of course a very important facilitating process for extraction, right? But so we don't get so much into the violence per se. But so what we're interested in is also basically looking or examining who is it that will come out on top amongst these mining companies and how in this energy transition. And so this is just the kind of initial scan that we did, right? Interrogating sort of company statements, interviews, annual reports, et cetera. But this is something that we hope to develop in the future. And so in terms of what we discovered was really trying to look closer, as said, on their investment strategies. And we conceptualized these investment strategies in terms of or make this distinction, of course, drawing on others, we can get into that in the Q&A, but in terms of intensification or extensification, right? Where I'll focus just on extensification for time reasons, which is about basically opening up new spaces of extraction, right? Thereby extending the geographical area of mining activities. And so as you can see on the figure here to the right, basically this shows prices in connection with exploration budgets. And so what we sort of identify in the report that there seems to be in the context of this so-called energy transition and these rising prices and hence increased prospective profits that I was talking about, there seems to be a real shift back towards this extensification strategy, right? With a kind of incipient rise in exploration budgets of the majors. And what this means is that over the coming years, if these exploration budgets materialize in actual extraction, we can expect a massive rise in mining projects, right? And what is kind of interesting in this shift is that many areas that previously in company terms used to be considered too high risk are now becoming profitable. So with that, I'll hand over the mic to Whit.
Excellent. Thanks very much, Mats. That's appreciated. I hope you can hear me. So as noted, my name is Andy Whitmore, but known to many as Whit, and I'm co-chair of London Mining Network and also facilitate its Just Transition Working Group. So following on from what Mads was saying, we looked at sort of what this extensification means in terms of new investment strategies, and drawing on it, I think first is very much that expansion into new geographical territories. And as Mads mentioned, these include kind of higher risk strategies, especially in Africa, but still in Latin America and Asia, but as well as a redoubled focus on mining in supposedly lower risk jurisdictions, such as the USA, Canada, Australia, and even Europe, where both of us are from. And I think the second then is in new technological developments. So that includes technology which improves how exploration is done, making it cheaper or quicker, or even developments into whole new industrial frontiers, such as deep sea mining. But also going back to intensification, as was on the last slide, some of those technical developments are more about intensification. So for instance, they include where you're improving the recovery rates you get from lower grades, or even from going back to waste to remine it, or technology replacing jobs, such as in Rio Tinto's kind of automated mine of the future, as they call it. Okay, so next slide. And so because the industry realizes it's going to face opposition to this expansion, it's focused on ways to address what the companies see as what they call a trust deficit with communities. So these strategies include, and I think it is just includes, but we've tried to take a few of them, an attempt at rebranding. So mining companies are increasingly calling themselves mineral solutions or material solution companies, because they're saying they're supposedly necessary for the energy transition. However, we don't believe this matches the reality. And a good example is shown in the graph here, which is BHP spending, BHP being the largest mining company in the world, is exploration for copper versus petroleum. And it's a little small to see, but basically the spending on copper is minuscule in comparison to petroleum, and yet it's copper it always talks about in terms of providing minerals for the energy transition. So the second is mining companies are increasingly taking up the idea of better engagement with stakeholders, as they call it. But you know, does this match the reality? In the paper, we examine the track record of Anglo American, which is keen to stress its credentials in engaging with communities. And we look at examples and basically show that that doesn't translate to what's happening in the ground. And indeed, the next report that we're working on at London Mining Network is actually doing an analysis of Anglo-Americans' kind of human rights claims against the reality. And then finally, the third is there's a reshaping of the power dynamic between companies and governments. So that includes, for instance, the expansion of voluntary standards, which have primarily been driven by the companies for the mining practices, but also victories companies are having using arbitration like the investor state dispute settlement mechanisms. Okay, next and final slide. So in the limited time we've got, that brings us back to questions. We finished the report with a set of challenging questions. We've kind of selected out and developed them here for the conference. So hopefully they can guide discussions later and some of the questions we can answer in the Q&A. So four questions. The first is, how do the different constituencies in society come together to challenge this vision that the mining industry has of itself and its vital role for the energy transition, which is going to be key because we come from so many different sectors, everywhere from the mine all the way through to the other end of the supply chain where we're consumers. So, and there are groups working on different aspects, including labour. Then, are minerals really required for the energy transition or for very specific visions of what it could be? So I think this is important. So for example, you know, are the materials that are being produced more about supporting the vision of private car ownership rather than the energy transition? And I think trying to pull apart what's actually required for the energy transition from effectively industrialization could be a really key idea. Then what are the opportunities for repurposing existing infrastructure and technology towards servicing human needs rather than profits? And then finally, what role is there for mining in the future? So, I mean, we all want to see a radical reduction in mining, but are we in a position where we'll ever be able to do without it at all? And if it's going to be done, you know, what are the preconditions that are required, both for local communities, for the environment, etc.? So I guess with that last, perhaps provocative question, we'll finish there. But thank you very much.
Thanks, Mats and Andy, for this excellent presentation and these indeed very provocative questions that I think give a lot of food for thought and will stimulate the discussion later on. So yes, we're moving to the next panel, the next speaker, which is Claire. Claire, please go ahead. As I said, she's able to screen share, so that is great. It's just her camera not working.
Right. Hello, everyone. Moving to acknowledge our country, I would like to acknowledge that we are living and working on the lands of the Maimunah and Palawa Pakenham peoples. I would like to acknowledge and pay respects to those that bravely fought in the frontier wars against the British Army's invasion and genocidal attacks. These were some of the first resistance campaigns against colonial extractive logics in Australia. I pay my respects to the elders past and for the groups that did survive the genocidal attacks. I pay my respects to the elders present and emerging. Always will be Aboriginal land. All right, so a little bit about the background of my research. Currently, the global strategy for decarbonisation is clean up electricity and electrify everything. Australia's mining sector, with support from governments, is positioning itself to capture the bulk of this opportunity, particularly in relation to battery minerals. As demand for lithium, nickel and cobalt rises, Australia's mining sector is labelling itself a reliable and robust source of these minerals. So Australia's mining and energy sector broadly considered has been considered as climate priors previously, given the export of coal and gas. So much of the research in this area is in relation to climate change and the mining focus on this. However, increasingly, the Minerals Council and the federal government are promoting both hydrocarbon and battery minerals mining expansions. However, Australia's mining sector is deeply entwined with fossil fuel captures and settler colonial violence, and there is a gap in the research around this emerging with legitimisation of this sector. So my research aim is to examine Australians' role in battery minerals supply chains using the lens of green extractivism and looking at what the legitimising factors are driving this and what are the costs. So I have a case study design and contextual analysis method, because we have a limited time, using political ecology and green extractivism as a lens. I understand green extractivism as a complex web of expanding extractivisms associated with the supply chains for new green economies, including the mining for materials used to produce battery technologies. This process follows conventional capitalist wealth accumulation, facilitated through globalized economic systems, including land grabbing, land control, and dispossession of agrarian based and indigenous lands. This also includes commodification of social nature and subjugation of human and non-human existences. Another aspect of green extractivism is the discourse with the power effect of legitimizing green sacrifice zones, shifting the burden of zero carbon lifestyles to ecologies and cultures of marginalized communities can be understood as generating these zones, which are evidence of the continuation of neo-colonial injustices. We can understand the logic of sacrificing a certain space or ecology to include places and populations that will be affected by the sourcing, transportation, installation, operation of solutions for powering low carbon transitions. And so I'm going to be looking at the extraction aspect of the green extractivism political social process. And I'll first turn to Australia settler colonial context as we look into the mining sector. So extractive settler colonial narratives and practices since the expropriation of First Nations lands have shaped politics, national identity and the landscape in Australia. For First Nations, dispossession, inequality and negative impacts on cultural practices are some of the main impacts. Environmentally, we find metal pollution really significant over these years. 100 billion tons of solid mine waste have occurred over the last 100 years, and tailings waste, discarded rock, has eroded rivers, streams, and causing sedimentation, chemical pollution. There's 50,000 abandoned mines across Australia, continuing to leach acid rock drainage, toxic chemicals. Sulfidic nature of soils have impacted significantly on the health of populations and through waterways and pollution of ecosystems, as well as the classic clearing of forests and native vegetation involved in mining. So Australia's mining sector is quite significant globally. 40% of the market share is held by key Australian mining companies. Some of those are two of the major ones are headquartered in Australia. The net worth of BHP, Rio Tinto and Xstrata outstrips the entire Australian federal government budget. The main commodities across the sector recently have been coal, iron ore, copper, bauxite, uranium and lithium. And 52.8% of that of the value are total exports of our total exports in Australia come from the mining sector. 86% of total share of the mining companies are owned by foreign interests, usually the United States and the UK. And we have this lobbying body, the Minerals Council, which wields significant power over the political economy. An example of this has been the inability to pass climate policies over recent over the past decade. Legitimized generally the mining sector by national development and neoliberal discourses and practices. And there's this narrative that's been longstanding, which is mining is essential to national identity, economic growth, and community development. Yeah, both sides of politics, political and financially support the sector. They have adopted environmental narratives and deploy these to legitimize mining, including clean coal, sustainable mining, and the latest being green mining, which has emerged in relation to legitimizing mining for clean energy economies. So I think folks know a little bit about lithium, but I'll just quickly go over this. By 2030, it looks like 74% of lithium demand will come from battery demands, which is estimated to deplete 53% of global deposits. Australia's economic policy context is supporting an expansion in lithium mining, seeking to be a global critical minerals powerhouse. The Quad, which is a group of nations operating in the Pacific area here, are prioritizing securing future supply chains of key battery minerals, and Australia is one of those key players in sourcing the minerals. And there are various different strategies, policies that are supporting this. Research grants have been awarded to integrated supply chain companies. While there's been small shifts in terms of reducing dependency on fossil fuels, Australia's mining sector continues to be energy intensive and powered by hydrocarbon. A little bit about Australia's style of lithium mining. It is a pretty intensive process akin to fracking or coal mining, involving drilling deep into the earth and the use of explosives to break up rock, roasting rock, high heat crushing, sulfuric acid leaching, which generates 94% of waste rock. And the refining is really damaging due to the risk of chemical contamination. So this industry is expanding quite rapidly. Australia's companies are expanding across the globe, but I'm going to focus today on domestic expansions. So new hotspots are emerging in Northern Queensland, Northern Territory, whilst Western Australia is the main sort of area, which is a mining district in Australia. A total of 25 companies are currently undertaking a combined 37 active lithium mining operational areas. Of those, 30 pertain to new exploration areas, which in most cases consist of multiple concession holdings. And 10 of the lithium projects are now included on Austrade's critical minerals projects list. That gives them sort of access to special status. And we've found that a project has been granted major project status by the federal government as a result of the critical minerals listing, and as well as a lithium refinery in WA. This allows companies to fast track approval processes and avoid some of those pesky laws. Western Australia, a little bit more about this region and where things are happening. It's already impacting areas like the Western, the Pilbara and Kalgoorlie, which are already well-known mining areas with cultural heritage and water rights being the key concerns there. An open pit proposal was set to impact on culturally significant water body. However, traditional owners negotiated for underground in that area, for an example. A large scale lithium project intended to expand further is the Pilbara Minerals project, where most of the lithium goes to China, and they've recently published record prices in 2021. The Cabo region, interestingly, in 2017, 3 billion litres of diesel fuel were imported into that area. Woodside's new Scarborough gas project in WA seeks to contribute to reducing the mining industry's emissions of gas, yet the project is estimated to be the equivalent to building 15 new coal power stations. The Pilbara region's history is fraught with violations against First Nations communities, ranging from dispossession, exclusion, to cultural heritage destruction. Without careful consideration, this region is likely to reproduce those conditions. Another example, world's largest lithium mine, sort of near Perth, this one. It has faced community opposition. It is actually a joint project between a Chinese company and a US company. Communities there are concerned with expanding waste tailings issues, and there's a giant tip nearby, this small town that relies on farming livelihoods and other tourism livelihoods that have been sort of opposing this project for quite a while. Another project that's emerging just nearby Perth is being opposed by grassroots community group because of its environmental significance. It's a nature reserve, home to a threatened native species.
Claire, I'm sorry to interrupt, but you have 2 minutes left. You need to start looking at Reddit, wrapping up. Thank you.
Outside of WA, you've got Cape York, Queensland, with around 1 million hectares of First Nations land that's facing expanding lithium mining. In Victoria, Tasmania as well, a lot of these areas are important for environmental values and tourism. Northern Territory is a key example as well. This one is a hotspot region with multiple companies expanding their open pit mine and concentrator plant south of Darwin, has received major project status, giving access to that streamlining of approvals and an agreement signed with Tesla. So local community groups are concerned particularly about groundwater damage, mine drainage, and other issues. So just quickly, I will wrap up. Australian companies, obviously, with the support of the governments, that's actually bipartisan support, are capitalizing on market-based responses to climate change. The expansion of mining activities are legitimized through combining conventional mining development discourse with green economy discourses. Significant social, cultural, and environmental impacts were found across many lithium hotspots, which indicate the emergence of green sacrifice zones. And these are all built off a history of violent dispossession and ongoing colonization of Indigenous and First Nations peoples. So the costs of mining are placed again on rural and remote communities. And while lithium mining produces some opportunities for short-term employment, it's largely for material export. And as we know, boom and bust with mining generates their own challenges. And the demands for electrification largely come from urban elite, environmental sort of conscious people who are likely not to be impacted by these sacrifice zones. The rapid capture of First Nations land for lithium mining has impacts, obviously, for considerations around a justice-based transition that haven't really been discussed. More research is required. There's very little research on lithium mining, and given it's so new, I think there's real case for examining this and for green policymakers to consider the limits of these expanding extractions in the name of consumer-based solutions or industrial energy solutions. And climate action must really look at the driving factors within this economic growth trajectories and consumption levels. Thank you.
All right, thanks very much, Claire. We're moving on to the next set of speakers. I believe that Marta wants to do a short introduction. Is that correct for this paper? I don't see them present. So I think we move just directly actually to the paper. So Siti and Melky, the floor is all yours.
Okay. Could you see my presentation? Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. My name is Siti Maimunah, and I am studying at University of Passau, Germany. Originally, I'm from Indonesia. Together with Adlun, a journalist and activist from North Maluku, and Taufik, so we changed the presenter, and Taufik, an activist living in Central Sulawesi. We are part of the Mining Advocacy Network, a national network supporting the community against extractivism in Indonesia. Thanks for having us here, and also thanks for Marta and Diego for the opportunity. Due to the time constraint, I will provide an introduction and closing, then Taufik and Adlun will share their view about nickel extraction. They will speak Indonesian, but you can read what they say in the screen in English. We will present the predatory connection on the extraction of nickel coal through the so-called green economy in Indonesia. Shortly after independence, with the rise of the authoritarian regime led by the military, Indonesia was known under the extractive regime, in which various extraction of natural resources supported by economy and politics, as shown in the following colors, the export commodities depending on the global market demand, which is inherent in the colonial historic and logic. So under the political system controlled by the extractive oligarch through what Jatam call ijon politik, it means when money transaction for the easy mining permits become a source of money to finance local and national elections. Business people, politicians, and the military are in power. And at the moment, more than half of parliamentarians are now associated with extractive business. You can see the number here. So the political system influences the changing of politics, policies that pro-extractivism and oligarch interests over times. For stages of policy change, support persistent extractivism that at least in the last 5 years, there has been a drastic change in a series of policies, including the amendment of the Mining and Coal Acts, and the creation what the government call omnibus law, which is they amendment 78 laws become one law, which consists more than 1,000 pages. So later, with the rising issues of the climate crisis, the governments call it Indonesia's way toward a green economy, with the ambition to make the country one of the world electric battery producer. Currently, Indonesia is frontier resource for nickel. So despite extracting nickel since more than half a century ago, nickel and rare earth mineral extraction have been accelerated by creating an industrial complex that integrates mining, smelter, battery component factories, and coal power plants. Interconnection with the development of cities and infrastructure. Two of them will share by Adun and Taufik, who live in the province where the largest nickel industrial complex in Indonesia, which is in Maluku, North Maluku and South Sulawesi. Adrun, the time is yours. Silakan, Adrun.
Yeah, I am Adlun from Halmahera Island, as Indonesian. I'm sorry, I'm speaking Indonesian. Di kampung saya di Maluku Utara ada sebuah industri besar namanya Indonesia Weda Bay Industrial Park. Mereka adalah industri nikel yang mengolah pronikel, kemudian memproduksi baterai kendaraan listrik. Mereka terintegrasi dengan kawasan mining yang tidak jauh dari kawasan industri. Mereka juga mengoperasikan PLTU. untuk menunjang listrik di kawasan industri. Integrasi ini adalah himpunan kapital, kemudian didanai secara intensif oleh lokal dan nasional. Kami melihat hubungan oligarki di sini, bahwa bupati di kabupaten kami, dia adalah seorang petinggi Partai Golkar yang memiliki hubungan dengan seorang jenderal yang juga menjadi Dewan Penasihat Golkar, namanya Luhut Binsar Panjaitan. Luhut Binsar Panjaitan ini merupakan Menteri Kemaritiman dan Investasi. Dia merupakan tangan kanan Presiden Indonesia Joko Widodo. Dia juga berafiliasi dengan sejumlah petinggi-petinggi militer. Sejak kawasan industri ini dibangun, mobilisasi polisi dan militer dan pembangunan markas-markas militer di sekitar kawasan industri. Adapun
boleh pelan-pelan dampak, tidak Bapak Adlun.
Ya. Adapun dampak-dampak daripada dibangunnya kawasan industri ini, yang pertama itu adalah hilangnya landscape hutan, kemudian sungai-sungai yang mengalami kerusakan dan tersedimentasi parah. Kemudian di pesisir laut, pantai-pantai itu tercemar akibat pendingin daripada PLTU dan smelter. Hal ini membuat nelayan-nelayan di kampung di sekitar kawasan industri ini wilayah tangkapnya menjadi jauh. Kemudian debu dari aktivitas industri ini menyebabkan masyarakat di sekitar itu, sekitar industri ini menderita penyakit ISPA. Selain itu dampak sosial ekonomi akibat datangnya karyawan, ribuan karyawan di industri ini membuat biaya hidup makin meningkat, kriminalitas dan konflik sosial lainnya. Terima kasih.
Adlun, thank you. And yeah, we pass to Taufik from Central Sulawesi. Taufik, the time is yours.
No, guys. Thank you, Mbak Mai. My name is Taufik. I'm from Indonesia and Central Sulawesi. I'm sorry and speak Bahasa Indonesia. Komplek industri nikel terintegrasi dalam wilayah kawasan industri milik Indonesia Berwal Industrial Park atau yang sering disebut IMIP dengan luas 2.000 hektar sejak 2015 yang menghimpun penambangan nikel seluas 40.000 hektar dan salah satu komisarisnya adalah Purnawirawan Jenderal. Pabrik nikel ini menggunakan PLTU sebanyak dengan kapasitas 2.000 MW untuk mengoperasikan pabrik dan asal batu baranya dari Pulau Kalimantan. Ada sekitar 40.000 pekerja Indonesia yang bekerja di sini dan 50 pekerja Tiongkok yang juga bekerja di wilayah kawasan industri ini. Selain itu, politisi lokal termasuk Jenderal Luhut Binsar Panjaitan, pembina Partai Golkar, Menko Kemaritiman dan Investasi, tangan kanan Presiden Jokowi, mempromosikan IMIP sebagai kawasan industri nikel terbesar kelima dunia yang menghubungkan hulu hilir penambangan dan pabrik yang memproduksi baja stainless steel. Teman baik LBP, Jenderal Sintong Panjaitan yang juga mantan Danjen Kopassus, diduga salah satu komisaris pada salah satu anak perusahaan PT Bintang 8 Mineral sejak 2019. Selain itu, keterlibatan elit dan politik lokal hingga nasional diduga terlibat sebagai pemodal atau pemilik tambang-tambang nikel yang memasok ore nikel ke PT IMIP. Kemudian putaran ini digunakan sebagai biaya politik dalam pilkada maupun pemilu di Indonesia. Nah, pengrusakan alam juga terjadi di semua wilayah kawasan hulu hingga hilir di wilayah kawasan industri ini. Meningkatnya kejadian banjir menghantam desa-desa di wilayah hulu yang ditambang nikelnya, seperti yang terjadi pada 2020 di Desa Dampala dan Simbatu di Kecamatan Bahodopi. Sementara di wilayah hilir, seperti Dusun Kurisa, Desa Patupia, udara yang dicemari limbah fleas PLTU dan pencemaran oleh smelter mengakibatkan gangguan pernapasan. Sementara di wilayah pesisir menjadi tempat pembuangan limbah air panas PLTU yang mengakibatkan hilangnya mata pencarian nelayan di sekitar kawasan industri. Thank you, Mbak Mai.
Thank you, Adlun and Taufik. I will continue. You can see how the doubles and the integration is not just, you know, the capital, but also the effect to the community and also the environments. Taufik and Adlun's story about nickel extraction cannot be separated from coal extraction and burning as a series of extractivism cycles, where at the Indonesian largest coal extraction on the island of Kalimantan, the destruction and violation of human and nature rights continue without any significant recovery. At the moment in Samarinda, for example, one of the capital city is Kalimantan. There is 40 people, most of it is children, drowned in the abandoned coal pits. So it's so that the green economy is actually the face of the green extractivism, which continues the predatory operation as the main character of extractivism. Predatory relation among humans, cities, villages, islands. You can see the link how, for example, nickel here extracting in another islands and then using a coal from Kalimantan and processing in Java. It's kind of the link of the predatory relation. Furthermore, it's also continuing the predatory among the state in the world. Predatory system through the jargon of green energy, net zero, and low carbon development are packaged in a green economy. So we close the presentation with reflection. According Indonesian experience, is important to see that the green economy is actually extractivism cover by green cover and become new source of funding for the for durability of oligarch in Indonesia and also military rules. So furthermore, it's important. I think it's challenge for us as academics and NGOs to understand the complexity of predatory characters of green extractivism, which is at the moment accelerated and irreversible. And the second, it's important to expose the danger of the campaign on the transition to renewable energy without the obligation to reduce the production consumption of mineral and energy, which in fact will multiply the damage to social ecological relation happening on the local and the planetary scale. And the third is important to link the production consumption of energy, whether it's from fossil fuels or big hydro dams on geothermal at the moment also accelerating in Indonesia, how to connect with the nickel and rare earth mineral and their integration with the development of industrial centers, finalization, industrial urbanism, security mobilization and their associated consequences to understand the complexity of nickel extraction and its social ecological impacts. Thank you.
All right, thanks very much for this fascinating presentation that I think demonstrates very well how green extractivism is part of a total extractivist complex and that we cannot isolate certain forms from other forms, but they are all integrated. And yes, then we're moving to our very last presentation by Emilinah Namaganda, who's going to talk about a very violent context, Cabo Delgado in Mozambique, where I think in the past weeks there have been numerous attacks, I think, on solar production plants as well as mining corporations. And maybe her presentation can shed some more light on what is happening there. Emilinah, please go ahead.
Sorry, Judith, would you help me to stop my share? I think my laptop has problems.
Your share has already stopped, so no worries there.
Okay, then I'll start mine. I hope you can hear me well.
Yes.
Thank you. My name is Emilinah Namaganda. I'm a PhD candidate at Utrecht University. And in my presentation, I'll be talking about the relationship between socio-environmental changes due to green extractivism in Cabo Delgado and violence within the province. So, one moment. Mozambique hosts several so-called green resources, and in the province of Cabo Delgado, which is located in the northeast. We especially have Africa's third largest natural gas reserves. And natural gas has been suggested by proponents as a bridge fuel to a low carbon future. And I think this has regained even more prominence due to recent global events. But the province also hosts the world's largest single deposit of high grade graphite, a mineral that is critical in lithium ion batteries that are used to power electric vehicles. So these resources have all been discovered or developed over the past decade. However, as Judith mentioned, since 2017, the province has also been suffering simultaneously from violent conflict. Okay, so here I show two maps that can give an indication of the overlap between the so-called green projects and events of violence within the province. So in the extreme northeast, you have the natural gas project. And then in the south, the graphite licenses. So three of these projects are already operational and all of them started within the last 5 years, whereas the others are yet to be developed. So this frontier of extraction is also expanding very rapidly within the province. And on the right, then you have a map that shows where violence has occurred within the province. This is from 2021 and it has been updated recently. So you can see that violence started in the north, close to the natural gas area. However, if you look up more recent maps, you'll be able to see that this has expanded west and southwards in the graphite mining areas as well. So in my presentation, which is based off of a paper I am developing, I'll make two contributions. One, the types of socio-environmental changes that we are seeing, including violent contestation, is actually quite similar to other extractivism within the country. However, it's happening more rapidly as we are seeing with graphite and exacerbating pre-existing conditions. And based on this, in this paper, I also argue for the role of theories, concepts, and methodologies that enable us to examine more fundamental and long-term causes of these extractivism impacts, including violence beyond singular projects. In the case of Mozambique, but also useful in other African contexts, I suggest African critical theory as beneficial. So this is a body of works by various African scholar activists such as Amilcar Cabral and Walter Rodney, who already came up in other presentations, who wrote critically about African experiences in past imperial domination, particularly during periods of slavery and colonialism. But this theory, among other aspects, also pays special attention to examining how the remnants of this period still play a significant role in contemporary political economic structures in Africa, for instance, via uneven development and extraverted economies, among other characteristics. And I suggest this theory to be very beneficial, among others that have a similar approach, because they enable us to examine how these enduring structural conditions are interacting with contemporary developments to induce the nature of extractivism impacts that we see today. And in my paper, I use a mix of geospatial and qualitative techniques to articulate these interactions. So specifically, I spent time in Cabo Delgado in 2018, 20, and 21, where I conducted interviews at various levels, so at community levels, but also institutional levels about the socio-environmental impacts of these projects. And then I followed this up subsequently with an analysis of satellite imagery for land use and land cover change within the locations where we currently see mining. And I focus especially on two graphite locations and the natural gas area. So for the benefit of this brief presentation, I use the results from the natural gas area to demonstrate the nature of impacts that we are seeing. So the natural gas area received, it's called a duat in Portuguese, but it's right to use land in 2012. So from 2012 onwards, the project could start developing its extraction related infrastructure and continue with the resettlement of people within the concession area, et cetera. So with these images, then, for example, the image on the right from 2020, it shows the current land use and land cover as is. It's from 2020, but it sort of depicts close to present situation. And then 5 years earlier in 2015, and then 2008, way before the project started any substantial construction, with the idea that we'd like to get an indication about how these landscapes are changing due to an increase in this mining or hydrocarbon extraction activities. And some of the patterns that we are seeing are, one, an increase in built up environment, but also an increase in low sparse vegetation, which includes cultivated areas. And a lot of these are especially being motivated by an increase in in-migration, often from outside the district. So in this case, outside Palma district, where the extraction is going on. So this area is very rural. So there wasn't a lot going on prior to the project. As you can see, for example, in the image, I don't know if you can see my cursor, but if you look at the image from 2008, Palma town is just outside the closest town to the concession area. Palma town is the closest town to the concession area. And in 2018, you know, it's very small. And then you see this increasing in 2015. And if you look at the image in 2020, this continues to expand quite quickly. And also within the concession area, you can see the increase in built up area, which is the orange color, to clarify. So you see this increase in orange color, which is depicting an increase in the built up area, whether due to people setting up businesses to take advantage of these natural gas extraction activities, or the project itself within the concession area setting up infrastructure. And in addition to built up area, the increase in vegetation is also linked to, you know, this increase in opening up agricultural frontiers, whether by locals or others that are coming from outside the district. And conversely, then you can see a decrease in dense vegetation, which is demonstrated using the very dark shade of green that goes on decreasing for now with time, but also wetlands that are very light shade of blue. So these types of patterns of changes that we could see from the land use land cover changes were also demonstrated. They also came up during the interviews, both at community and institutional level, but I highlighted the community interviews especially for this presentation. And I went ahead to also highlight in red, there's so many things that came out of the interviews and they have so many different implications, but in red I have highlighted those that we have found and others have also found to be most strongly connected to the violent contestation that we see in the province. So what you see from the spatial changes that, what you don't see from the spatial changes, but that we garnered from the interviews, which is why these types of methodologies can be so complementary, is that the expansion of these settlements and the expansion of towns in the case of Palma is actually strongly stimulated by in-migration. So by people from outside that district or from other parts of the country, for example, the capital in the south that are historically more educated and can take better advantage of the opportunities presented by these types of projects, but also people from outside the country who have the capital to set up hotels and other businesses that can link more closely to the natural gas project. So what you have then is the local population being extremely marginalized from the developments. And a combination of these spatial but also interview analysis could then indicate how spatially the area is changing. So you can see, and the people that write about, you know, enclaves have also emphasized this. So you see these structures coming up and people flowing into the province, but then there is very little socioeconomic development happening in the area. So there is a very loose integration between these projects and the local socioeconomy. And so linking this back in the case of Mozambique, particularly to the Africana critical scholarly literature, you can see that Cabo Delgado, for instance, has been a zone of resource extraction for export with very limited benefits locally. And this can be exemplified, for example, within the colonial period, there was a compulsory cotton growing, which was also characterized by harsh labor practices and a lot of violent displacement and resettlement, and with limited socioeconomic impacts. And more recently, there is ruby mining. And now, and this is when then you add the natural gas and graphite projects that have been placed under the banner of green extractivism, but operate more in more or less a similar form. So you see a history in Cabo Delgado of marginalization that also other scholars in Mozambique have identified and established. And we see this as a bedrock that has operated with other factors such as religious radicalism, then to stimulate this violent contestation against long-term marginalization that has over time erupted into armed violence. So from our research, or from this paper specifically, I would like to conclude by saying indeed green extractivism, also called green extractivism, is opening up new frontiers of extraction, as we saw from how rapid the graphite, for example, is expanding. However, the socio-environmental changes that we see are very similar to other extraction and are only occurring more rapidly and exacerbating pre-existing conditions. And this is the basis upon which I suggest or propose in this paper that in order for us to really understand the type of violence we're seeing, for example, in Cabo Delgado, that's linked to extractivism, it is important to examine more long-standing structures of uneven development and extraverted economies that are always geared towards, you know, whether the global north and export and doing very little locally. And for this, I do suggest and strongly argue for the role of these theories, concepts, and methodologies that enable us to look beyond, you know, one particular project, but rather the, you know, fundamental structures and also the multiplicity of all these projects happening at the same time. And I found for now Africana critical theory and a mix of geospatial and qualitative methods helpful. Thank you.